If you're joining us, we are presenting ESMO 2022 GU Oncology Conference Highlights. Dr. Vincent Shute will be discussing kidney cancer updates with discussion from Dr. Tony Schwer.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Bertrock. So we'll be discussing kidney cancer from ESMO 2022. And the really short of it is that this was a huge conference for kidney cancer. Never before seen, we have five randomized phase three trials in kidney cancer presented for the first time in ESMO 22. So lots of exciting data. Not going to be able to go over everything today, but we'll try to hit some of the highlights. Number one, Cabo-Nivo-Ipi, the first randomized phase three triplet, has superior progression-free survival versus Nivo-Ipi. That's COSMIC-313. We had presented three negative adjuvant or perioperative immunotherapy trials in kidney cancer, Ipi-Nivo, Atezo, and perioperative nivolumab. So three disappointing large phase threes. We had another phase three of Bempeg plus Nivo that did not meet its endpoint in the first line setting. Another negative phase three. In other news, belzutifan data continues to be quite promising in both VHL, germline, and clear cell kidney cancer. And we'll show some data from lenvatinib and pembro, which has some promising results in non-clear cell kidney cancer. So we'll start with COSMIC-313. This is a randomized phase three trial, patients with intermediate or poor IMDC risk, previously untreated. So first line clear cell kidney cancer. And this is really the first phase three trial to use a modern comparator arm, comparing cabozantinib, ipi plus nivo, this triplet combination, with placebo plus ipi plus nivo. So really the first phase three, cannot be said enough, that had the courage to go up against a doublet. The baseline characteristics were pretty typical of an intermediate to poor risk population. There was a relatively low, only 65% of patients had a prior nephrectomy. And the rates of nephrectomy in clinical practice have been going down a little bit ever since the publication of Carmina. Looking at the headline results, going straight to the point, progression-free survival was improved for the triplet compared to ipi-nivo, with a pretty convincing hazard ratio of 0.73, favoring cabo-ipi-nivo, and a p-value of 0.01, which was significant. Looking at subgroups, the triplet for PFS looked better across most subgroups. The one interesting outlier was that the triplet seemed to do better in the intermediate patients versus the poor-risk patients. And it's not entirely clear why this was the case. One might expect that in patients with really aggressive poor risk disease, that being more intensive with therapy with a triplet would be better, but that was not the case in this trial. And we'll talk about some reasons potentially why that might be the case. Looking again at the intermediate versus poor risk, as you can see from the Kaplan-Meier curves, intermediate risk, the triplet PFS curve separated early and remained separated. Whereas in poor risk, the curves crossed and the two curves were not significantly different among the IMDC poor risk patients. It is kind of interesting a little bit that in the poor risk patients, you get an early TKI separation where the cabo triplet does better early on and the curves cross later. Again, we'll speculate a little bit about why that might be the case. Looking at tumor response, as might be expected, three drugs has a higher response rate compared to two drugs. The partial response rate was higher in the triplet as well versus ipi-nivo. However, the complete response rate was only 3% in both arms, which is quite a bit lower than what we saw in CheckMate 214 with ipi-nivo. And you know, there may be some reasons why these patients had a poor complete response rate, but one of them may be that there was a lower rate of nephrectomy in this trial population. And we know that in patients with a primary tumor in place, getting that tumor to entirely disappear on systemic therapy alone is oftentimes very difficult. These are the waterfall plots showing that there was a greater proportion of responses in the triplet compared to the doublet. But once again, the complete response rate was not particularly high. Safety. As might be expected, three drugs are more toxic than two drugs. And I especially want to point out that the proportion of patients receiving all four planned doses of ipilimumab was higher for ipi-nivo compared to ipi-nivo plus cabo. And this is probably due to more patients in the triplet arm having toxicity early on, requiring either systemic steroids or holding the ipilimumab. And clearly, many patients who had ipi held did not end up receiving all their ipi doses. And similarly, treatment-related adverse events leading to discontinuation were higher among the triplet arm. Looking at the safety broken down, there was an increased rate of liver toxicity among the triplet compared to the doublet. And this is consistent with our knowledge that cabo, in addition to ipi-nivo, does have some rate of liver toxicity. And this appears to add up a little bit. 58% of patients getting the triplet received high-dose steroids, defined as a prednisone dose of 40 milligrams or greater, and 35% received high-dose steroids with ipi-nivo. So putting this into context, these are our current first-line therapies, doublets, for intermediate and poor-risk clear cell renal cell cancer. And as you can see, this triplet combination is the first triplet to ever show PFS superiority against a doublet. However, with a very strong caveat that we do not have any overall survival data. And so I think it's fair to say that how the overall survival data pans out from this triplet will really inform where this triplet will or will not fit in into first-line clinical practice. So let's move on to adjuvant and perioperative therapy. There's three trials, and we'll start with adjuvant atezolizumab. So this was a randomized phase 3 trial comparing atezolizumab for 1 year versus placebo for 1 year among patients with resected intermediate high-risk RCC that had a clear cell and or sarcomatoid component. In an important difference compared to KEYNOTE-564, which was the adjuvant pembrolizumab data that was presented previously and led to approval of pembro in this setting, for this particular trial, M1-NED patients were required to be either synchronous or metachronous over 12 months after primary surgery. And as you'll remember, for the pembrolizumab trial, the metachronous M1-NED patients were required to be within 12 months. So a different M1-NED population here. Based on characteristics, the vast majority of patients had clear cell kidney cancer, and a very small minority had other histologies. This is investigator assessed DFS, and as you can see, there was really no significant difference between curves. Atezolizumab and placebo performed very similarly with a p-value of 0.5, so not supporting the use of atezolizumab in this setting. Subgroup analyses showed no standout benefit to atezolizumab in any particular subgroup, except that females seem to do better on atezolizumab, and it's not clear whether that has any biological significance. That signal with female sex does not bear out in the other adjuvant trials. There was some sense that in patients with quite high PD-L1 expression, over 5%, there may have been a benefit to atezolizumab with a favorable hazard ratio of 0.57, but I'll point out that only 56 patients on atezo, so this is a relatively small subset. Overall survival also really no difference here. Safety was similar to previously described safety of atezolizumab, which was quite well tolerated. But my takeaway from this trial is that atezolizumab was well tolerated, but had no benefit in the adjuvant setting. The next perioperative trial is PROSPER, which is a clinical trial that many people at DFCI were involved in. This is a trial that randomized patients who were getting resection for RCC to neoadjuvant and adjuvant nivolumab versus observation alone. So there was no placebo on this study. Baseline characteristics are notable that half of patients had clinical T1 or T2 disease prior to randomization. And after surgery, about 80% of patients or more had, about 66% of patients had T3 or T4 disease, meaning that actually 34% of patients had only pathologic T1, T2 at time of surgery. Also want to point out that 20% of patients did not have clear cell RCC at time of surgery. And so it's possible that there was some dilution in this trial among patients with lower pathologic stage and also with non-clear cell kidney cancers that might have been less likely to respond to immunotherapy. Patient disposition is worth pointing out that among patients randomized to surgery plus nivolumab arm, 404 patients were randomized, but only 314 patients actually got any doses of adjuvant nivolumab. So that speaks to significant dropout in the nivolumab arm of this study. Recurrence-free survival was the primary endpoint. The trial was stopped early for futility. And as you can see, there is really no difference between the nivolumab and observation arms seen with a p-value of 0.43. We don't currently have overall survival data yet for this trial. Subgroup analyses show no subgroup with clear benefit to nivolumab. So next, I'll discuss adjuvant nivolumab plus ipilimumab versus placebo. This is part A of the CheckMate 914 trial. This is a randomized trial. Patients with predominant clear cell histology, RCC, randomized to 6 months of ipi-nivo versus 6 months of placebo after surgery. Baseline characteristics were typical of this population, though I'll point out that this trial did not include M1-NED, and most patients were international. Disease-free survival was, again, not different between the treatment and placebo arms. P-value of 0.53 and a hazard ratio of 0.92, showing really no significant benefit from ipi-nivo versus placebo. Looking at subgroup analyses, there was some sense that patients with sarcomatoid features, really aggressive histology, may have had some benefit from ipi-nivo, but this was quite a small subgroup, the total of only 40 patients. Safety was consistent with the previously described safety profile of ipi-nivo, which is to say that ipi-nivo is fairly toxic and certainly the most toxic out of all these perioperative immunotherapies. There were 57% of patients who completed at least four doses of ipi-nivo, and 43% of patients on the ipi-nivo arm discontinued treatment due to toxicity. And so this was fairly toxic and no clear benefit based on DFS. So what is the landscape now for adjuvant immunotherapy in kidney cancer? Remember from last year, we had KEYNOTE-564, which was pembrolizumab versus placebo for 12 months. And that was a strongly positive trial with a convincing p-value and also what looks like a strong trend towards potential overall survival benefit. So adjuvant pembrolizumab is approved by the FDA and is the only FDA-approved immunotherapy in this space right now. Now this space got more complicated in the last 3 weeks with three negative perioperative immunotherapy trials. All these trials have some idiosyncrasies. They're not equivalent trials. So let's look at some of the differences between the trials. Well, with PD-L1 blockade, we know that atezolizumab and avelumab, these PD-L1 inhibitors, seem to have consistently underperformed PD-1 inhibitors across multiple trials in renal cell cancer. So potentially, this is just a slightly less active agent. As for the perioperative nivolumab trial, there was only one dose of neoadjuvant nivolumab given. And also there was quite a lot of patient dropout. So it remains to be seen as we get more data from this trial, whether the dropout and the perioperative issues really bias this trial towards the null. For ipi-nivo, this was a relatively toxic adjuvant regimen, was given for only 6 months versus 12 months. So it's possible that the toxicity really limited this particular combination. So for now, pembrolizumab is still FDA approved and is the only adjuvant immunotherapy for RCC. And we need more data from these trials and hopefully biomarkers to help us select which patients actually benefit. The other key news is about belzutifan. So this is the new drug class, HIF-2 alpha inhibition in renal cell cancer. And we continue to get promising data that belzutifan does have activity in both VHL and sporadic clear cell kidney cancer. First, there was updates from cohort 1 of LITESPARK-003, which is first-line treatment with a non-immunotherapy doublet. So this is belzutifan plus cabozantinib, VEGF receptor plus HIF-2 alpha inhibition in the first line. This combination had an impressive overall response rate of 57% and a disease control rate of 94%. This is a small trial, but these numbers line up pretty well with our existing doublet combinations. All patients with available scans in this first-line trial had reduction in their target lesion size. Median PFS was 30 months and OS was not reached. Kind of interesting, and the first combination that doesn't involve immunotherapy in the first-line space with this kind of result. Safety signals were similar to what we know about cabozantinib and belzutifan. The most common adverse events were anemia and diarrhea, and patients, a small minority, had hypoxia, which is a known complication of belzutifan. Next, LightSpark-003 cohort 2. This was previously presented, and we got an update through a poster. The overall response rate for cabozantinib plus belzutifan in refractory RCC patients is 31%. And again, 86.5% of patients had reduction in target lesion size with an overall response rate of 29%. So this shows that the same combination cabo-belzutifan continues to have activity as well in the refractory RCC setting. Next, we have an update on LightSpark-004, which is belzutifan in VHL disease. This continues to be extremely impressive. Monotherapy with belzutifan, 92% of patients had a reduction in target lesion size with an overall response rate of 64%. And as you can see with the waterfall plot, that is very, very favorable. Not only in VHL-associated kidney cancer, but in other VHL-associated cancers, there was impressive response with the vast majority of patients having tumor shrinkage for CNS hemangioblastomas and PNETs. We continue to see a significant reduction in the need for surgical procedures in these patients with VHL disease. So on the right side in green is after initiation of belzutifan. As you can see, the need for surgeries drops off significantly. The safety profile continues to be consistent with what we know about belzutifan, with anemia, fatigue, and a small number of patients with hypoxia. And belzutifan, of course, as of this past year, is FDA approved in VHL-associated kidney cancer. So a small plug for ongoing phase 2 and 3 trials targeting this pathway. We have several of these trials currently open at DFCI. Adjuvant pembrolizumab plus belzutifan versus pembrolizumab is opening soon. We have currently open the triplet trial, which includes an arm with belzutifan, lenvatinib, and pembrolizumab versus either standard of care lenpembro or a triplet with CTLA-4 plus lenpembro. And we have belzutifan plus cabozantinib, what I just presented, open here as well. Belzutifan versus everolimus in refractory RCC. The phase 3 trial has completed accrual, and we hope to get data soon. And there's also a belzutifan plus lenvatinib refractory trial, which is currently open elsewhere. So don't forget as well, we have a different HIF2-alpha inhibitor, NKT-2152, which we also have here as a phase 1 trial. A couple other important trials to round things out. BEMPEG is a pegylated IL-2 prodrug, which was designed to preferentially activate CD8 T cells and NK cells rather than Tregs. This was a large randomized phase 3 trial for BEMPEG plus NEVO in the first line setting among patients with RCC, and unfortunately failed to meet its primary endpoint. The comparator arm was sunitinib or cabozantinib, so investigator's choice of VEGF receptor TKI. As you can see, single agent TKI actually had a better response rate than the BEMPEG-NEVO combination. So unfortunate results for this combo. And looking at the Kaplan-Meier curve, there was no significant difference with a p-value of 0.19, although the hazard ratio slightly favored BEMPEG plus NEVO. But again, with a p-value of 0.19, really did not meet its endpoint whatsoever. Looking at the intermediate to poor risk population, there was a subset of patients with high baseline PD-L1, which seemed to have some benefit, but it is unclear whether the same benefit would have been had from just single line nivolumab, right? So what's really unclear is how much, if anything, BEMPEG is adding to nivolumab in this particular population. And as we can see, the side effects effect profile is also bearing this out, with the side effect profile of Bempeg plus Nivo really quite similar to the side effect profile of nivolumab by itself. Again, raising the question of Bempeg may not add much toxicity, but also may not add much efficacy. Next, we have quite, I think, interesting and actually potentially practice-changing data in non-clear cell RCC. So this is a trial of pembrolizumab plus lenvatinib, this doublet combination among patients with non-clear cell RCC. The majority of patients had papillary RCC, and minorities of patients had chromophobe, unclassified translocation, or other. This is the waterfall plot from this study. There was a promising overall response rate of 47.6%. And in particular, we saw very nice responses in patients with papillary and unclassified or other histologies. I would want to point out that the response rates for patients with chromophobe histology did seem considerably lower compared to these other non-clear cells. And so here's a nice summary slide that was presented by Dr. Fei looking at regimens in non-clear cell kidney cancer. As we can see, compared to these other historical regimens, len-pembro has very nice results in this non-randomized study for unclassified translocation or papillary RCC. However, for chromophobe RCC, we probably shouldn't be doing len-pembro. And based on prior trials, including len-everolimus and Aspen, we know that patients with chromophobe RCC probably should still be getting a regimen that contains everolimus. So with that, I'm going to close that, and I'm going to ask Dr. Schweri, our discussant, to help us with his comments.
Yep, thank you. Nice presentation. Any questions?
I don't see any, Tony. Are there any commentary that you want to make?
No, I think it was a very rich meeting in GU and in kidney cancer. 5 phase 3 trial was impressive doing the plenary. I think one of the questions that was asked, which I answered a lot from Dr. Mittal, former alumni from Cleveland Clinic. Have we seen TTPs with HIF2 inhibitor, like when we maximized VEGF TKI and VEGF like and bevacizumab? No, we have not seen that. We look specifically at this. We have not seen it. The big picture here, about a triplet. Is triplet going to supplement doublet? I don't know. I'm not sure yet. OS at first interim. We have another interim and a final analysis was negative. Knowing you're not going against sunitinib, you're going against nivo-ipi, and at some point after 2 years, we stopped really, literally having events. So that's one. And that's why the PITT population went up from 450 to 550 patients. So the denominator was larger, which didn't influence the power at all. The response rate are a bit disappointing, but then you will see in the manuscript that a large number of patients had the kidney tumor as the target tumor. And we know here, this is a large tumor. We rarely achieve even a response, let alone CR. So remain to be seen. It's a positive trial. The good thing about it is that the curves separate early and there is a plateau, which we never seen with a TKI plus IO before. So it could be that, some of the IPI effect because it's in both arms. Adjuvant, I think here, Vincent put really ably so why the other studies are different. As a reminder, KEYNOTE-564 is the largest, the only one that bordered almost 1,000 patients, everything else between 700 and 800, with some heterogeneity, especially PROSPER. I think one of the things that bothers me is why the hazard ratio, I could understand maybe at ESO, why it was really almost one. It's almost like giving something and there was no even signal. And this is going to be for a long time debated, but we're still looking at the data. Thank you.